Tonight, Dick and I want to share with you a pivotal life experience that we had regarding our relationship to the Sabbath. But I've got to back up a little bit because I almost missed it. Dick and I both teach at Andrews University Seminary, and he teaches Old Testament. And you know, a basic tool for an Old Testament teacher would be learning the Hebrew language. And he'd learned the Hebrew language in his studies, and he knew how to translate and work with the dead language, but he'd always dreamed to go to Israel to study Hebrew. Always dreamed it. Because he said, you know, the real test that you know a language is that you can dream in that language. He said, I can't even think in Hebrew. I can translate, but I want it to come alive for me, because that's just a basic tool for an Old Testament teacher. You can imagine that. And I'd listen, and I would just hope he could do that sometime too. Well, he decided to apply for a sabbatical from Andrews University and go study at a Hebrew olpon. Because in Israel, the Israeli government plans these Hebrew language intensive schools. And they subsidize them, and so that Jews, as they immigrate back to Israel, they can come back and learn their mother tongue. Because they're coming from all these different countries, and they don't know how to speak Hebrew, and that's the mother tongue, and that's the language used in Israel. And so Dick dreamed of going to one of these olpons and have 8 hours of day. This is not staying in my ear very well. 8 hours of day of intensive language study. And so he applied, and we never dreamed it would happen. But he came home one day and he said, honey, you're not going to believe this. They granted my request for a sabbatical. We can go to Israel and study. I can go there and it'll be a dream come true for me. And I knew it was, and I wanted him to do it, and I knew he would get his airline ticket paid, and I knew I wouldn't. And so my mind was thinking very quickly, and so I said, oh, honey, I'm so thrilled for you. And I was totally honest and sincere about this. And I said, I've got the best idea. You go there and study Hebrew. Oh, I'm just so thrilled. And I'll take the kids and we'll go stay with my folks, because they never get to see the grandkids anyway, and we'll go stay. It'll be the perfect solution. And I thought it was the perfect solution. And then Dick, who knows me very well, he came and put a hand on each shoulder, and he said, JoAnn, if you don't think we can afford to go now, let's not go, because I don't want to go without you. Well, that put me in a real pickle. And this is the part of the story I really don't like to admit, but I said, okay, maybe we shouldn't go now. And then we went to bed, and Dick promptly fell asleep, and God started working on my conscience. You know how you do that? You go to bed and you think you've made a good choice, and God starts working on your conscience, you know. And my husband was sound asleep, and I couldn't sleep because God kept increasing the volume, you know. And finally, after a couple hours, I knew I'd made the wrong decision, and so I nudged him, and I said, well, maybe we should go to Israel now. And he said, okay, and he promptly fell back to sleep. And the next level of my maturing process began. Because, you know, sometimes you make choices that you know that God wants you to make, but you are angry that that's God's will. Have you had that happen? And I knew I'd made the right choice, but I was angry that this was God's will for me. I was angry that this was God's will for my life. But I knew I wanted Dick to go, and I knew if we didn't go, he would never get a chance, and he deserved to go, no question about it. Now I have to admit something else about my life. Some people decorate their homes in Mediterranean. Everything matches and is so lovely. And some people decorate their homes in Oriental. My parents were missionaries in the Orient when I grew up, and so my mother's always had everything very Oriental, very nice. Well, the Davidsons, we've always decorated in what I call early relative. And we've had a rather eclectic blend of couches and chairs and tables from his parents and my parents and grandparents and uncles and aunts. And if you squint your eyes and your eyelashes get in the way, it sort of goes together. And I hadn't told Dick this, but someday I had a dream that we would buy a couch that I chose, the color I wanted, and that the piping was still sewed on. Because our couches were so old that we turned the piping over, the worn side over. I mean, we used the worn side during the week, but then when we had people for lunch, you know, you turn it over and you fluff it up, and so it looks so nice, and you sit on it and you fall flat, you know. And I had a dream that someday, if we had any money left in savings, that we would buy a couch, a choice that I made, that I wanted, and the piping would still be sewed on. Am I too? Okay, thank you very much. And so I never told Dick this. He had not a clue that this was an idea in my mind, because I didn't want him to feel bad and I wanted him to go to Israel. But I knew how much money it would take to buy an airline ticket to go to Israel, and I knew that my little savings fund would be depleted after we bought my ticket and the ticket for our kids. And so I never told him this until later. And later I told him, honey, you're never going to guess what was in my mind when I didn't want to go to Israel. I wanted to buy a couch. And he laughed and he said, well, you know what was in my mind? He said, if we ever had any money left, I was going to buy a car with a floor. Because when we went back to Andrews University, we were very poor. And Dick was in school and I was in school. And then when he was done going to school, they hired him on to teach there. But that was, we had no clue that that was going to happen. And so we had an old car that we brought to Michigan. And you know, you don't do that here, but they put salt on the roads. And our old car, the floor totally rusted out. Really, I'm not talking about little holes, I'm talking about no floor. And my brilliant husband thought of the perfect solution. You put wooden boards in because they wouldn't rust. And he told me, honey, good-natured as he is, he said, honey, you're not going to believe this is the perfect solution. This is such an old car that if the engine ever goes out with no floor, we can, you know, walk it home. And so he had an idea. He said, when he laughed at my couch story, he told me, well, I had a better idea. I wanted a car with a floor. Notice his sweet spirit didn't even want a new car. All he asked was a car with a floor. Well, anyway, I was wrestling with all these ideas that night and counting up the money and knowing how much money I'd have to draw. But boy, I became a martyr to the cause. I was going to do God's will if it killed me. I was going to be a good wife, and Dick was going to have his dream come true because I knew he wouldn't go without me. And boy, I didn't want to go to Israel. You know, you make a list of things you want to do in a lifetime, right? Oh, before I die, I hope I can do this, this, and this, and this. Going to Israel wasn't even on my list. It wasn't there. But boy, I was going to do this for Dick because he deserved it. And I was going to do this. Okay. So I went to the bank and drew out all our money, bought our tickets. We flew to Israel. And I was going to be a good wife, muttering under my breath the whole time. So we got there, and I remember that night as we drove in a cheroute, you know, the Israeli taxi from Tel Aviv airport down to Jerusalem, and we got into Jerusalem, and if you've been there, you know what I'm talking about, Independence Park, downtown Jerusalem, and the taxi driver had to circle around Independence Park to get to the little side road to our little room that we were going to stay in, and wouldn't you know it, it was a Jewish festival that week, and our Jewish brothers and sisters were in the park singing songs of praise to God and praising God for the law, and they had Torah scrolls on their shoulder, and they were praising God. It was the most extraordinary thing I'd ever seen, and Dick said, let's go, and I said, well, I don't want to get shot. And so he said, so had the taxi driver go to the room, and we put the kids to bed. He said, well, I'm just going to go down for a little while, and then I'll be right back. And so I was putting the kids to bed, and 15 minutes later, he came back, because we were just a block away from Independence Park, and he came in and said, honey, you've got to come. The kids will love it. It's just wonderful. And I said, is it safe? So yes, it's safe. And so we bundled up the kids, and we went down there, and it truly was a wonderful experience. I had never heard anybody thank God for the law. Never heard of such a thing. I mean, I like the law, but sing praise to God for the law was wonderful. And so then we enjoyed that, and the next level of my maturing process began. That the media sometimes makes difficult situations in other countries worse than it really is, right? Well, right now it's pretty serious, but back then it wasn't as serious as the media made it out to be. And so we enjoyed that first experience of celebrating a Jewish festival with families and rabbis and children singing songs of Zion and praise to God. It was just absolutely wonderful. So we went back to our room, and Dick went next day down to sign up for his Hebrew class, and he went to his Hebrew ulpan, 8 hours of intensive Hebrew, nothing but Hebrew spoken. He had a marvelous teacher, and he'd come home and inspire us with the things he was learning and how this wonderful lady was teaching the beauty of the Hebrew language and the sacredness of this language that God chose above all languages to reveal his way to his people. And he'd teach us the Hebrew songs, and then he started making friends with the students in his class. And wouldn't you know it, these hospitable people started inviting us to their house. And so we started going to the homes of his classmates on Friday night and on Sabbath. Well, I thought, how nice. I mean, they were really lucky to have us there. I mean, we were Sabbath keepers too, you know. And I even knew the Sabbath commandment by memory. And I knew when the Sabbath started. I knew it started Friday night and ended Saturday night. I mean, that's the plain in the Bible. I knew that. But we started going to their precious homes. And after several times of beginning the Sabbath with them and spending Sabbath with these wonderful Jewish people, I remember coming home one night and falling on the floor and saying, "Oh, Lord, can you forgive me?" I'm a fourth generation Seventh-day Adventist, and I thought I knew all there was that could be known about the Sabbath. And I really liked the Sabbath. But after celebrating that, bringing in the Sabbath with our Jewish brothers and sisters, suddenly I realized that I had so much to learn. Because not only did the Jewish people like the Sabbath, they loved the Sabbath. It is the most extraordinary day. It's not a matter of coming to the end of the week and collapsing and rejuvenating yourself. You look forward to it all week. It's the only day of a week with a name. All the other days of the week on the calendar, 6 days to the Sabbath, 5 days to the Sabbath, 4 days to the Sabbath. The Sabbath is the only day with a name. It's such an extraordinary day, and it just no matter what they do, the Sabbath is exalted, and they're praising God for this gift, this incredible gift. And as we watched our Jewish brothers and sisters celebrate the beginning of the Sabbath and the closing of the Sabbath, it just stirred my heart. And it made such a difference in our lives and in our family when I suddenly realized that the Sabbath was not something I do for God. See, all my life I thought, "Yes, Lord, you said the seventh day is your Sabbath. Yes, I've memorized the commandment. Starts Friday night, ends Saturday night at sundown. Lord, I'm going to do this for you. End Sabbath, how did I do? Was that good? Thank you very much. Did I do well? Thank you very much." And that was my Sabbath keeping, and I liked it. You know, I was glad for the Sabbath. It was plain as day that this was God's holy day, no question about it. But finally I learned that the Sabbath is not something I give to God. It's a gift from the Creator to me. And the Jewish people who have been keeping Sabbath a lot longer than we have, I mean, the Seventh-day Adventists, we haven't been keeping Sabbath for 200 years yet, and our Jewish brothers and sisters have been celebrating and developing the delicate art and joy of Sabbath keeping for thousands of years, and their traditions are just heartwarming. And as our family started using this, it made such a difference for me in my love of God and my love of His Sabbath. So tonight I thought it would be a special time for us to walk through some of these beautiful traditions together that our Jewish brothers have been and sisters have been doing for thousands of years. No doubt Jesus even did some of these traditions because they go way, way back. And then we're going to pretend we're a big family tonight, okay? Dick and I always wanted a lot of children, so this'll do, honey. This'll do. And so we're gonna pretend we're a big family, and Dick is our dad, and I'm the mom, and we're gonna walk through some of these heartwarming, sacred traditions to bring in the Sabbath. And then I wanna share with you where they got these ideas. Because I thought, how can I have been a Seventh-day Adventist all this time and not thought of this? How could I? And so they showed me right from the Old Testament, the very Sabbath text that we use and love, they see something there because they read it in the original language. And we'll go through that. But first of all, let's pretend we're in Israel, in Jerusalem, and it's Friday afternoon, and we're getting ready for the Sabbath. And it's the most wonderful thing because it gives you a hint of what heaven's going to be like. Now, Dick and I live near Andrews University, about 6 miles from Andrews University, and boy, Friday afternoon, the campus closes down. You know, something's different. As one of my colleagues says, well, Adventists may not keep Sabbath very well, but they sure know how to keep Friday afternoon. And indeed, the whole campus closes down, and you can tell it's not a normal day. But you go to the very next city, and life goes on as usual, and Saturday's the biggest biggest day for merchants in the whole week, and so it's just absolutely a glorious thing. But in Israel, the whole country closes down. On Friday afternoon, all the businesses close down, and dads are rushing home with a bouquet of flowers under their arms, and grape juice, and challah bread, the braided bread that you could only get in Israel on Friday. Now, Jews and Arabs are both great bread bakers. You can get wonderful pita and all kinds of shapes of bread. The Arabs make a beautiful ring bread, and oh, it's just wonderful bread there. But only on Friday you can get the challah bread, the braided bread that they make just for Friday night and Sabbath. And dads will come home with two loaves under their arms, because you have to put two loaves on the table to remind you of the double portion of manna that fell in the wilderness for 40 years to prepare them for Sabbath. And they have grape juice, and they set the table with the finest china and crystal. The first time I went to a Jewish home Friday night, I said, whoa, this is beautiful. I thought maybe royalty was coming for supper. I mean, you know, we put out our best dishes for Sabbath lunch maybe, but not Friday night. Not Friday night. I mean, you know, what time does the sun go down? 8:30? 25 minutes after 8, you're doing the last vacuuming, and you're shoving it into the closet door when you're done, and you shut the door. 8:29, you're ready for the Sabbath, and you fall dead on the floor. And the blood pressure doesn't start rising till the next morning. And I know you must have good organ, good pastors in Oregon that preach great sermons, and so the sermon can become a peak of your Sabbath day. And then you come home and eat Sabbath dinner, and that's the peak meal of the week, and even the food tastes better on Sabbath. But then everything goes downhill rather fast, and you start watching your watch till it's finally over. But that's not the feeling you get in Israel. You feel all week the anticipation rising, and Friday afternoon is just peak. And in Jesus' day, to mark the separation of the weekdays from the Holy Sabbath, the priest would stand on the corner of the Temple Mount and give the signal on the shofar horn. Now, unfortunately, there are no more high priests left in Israel because the temple isn't there, but I brought us a priest along. Honey, would you blow the shofar for us and draw us into Sabbath and make that wonderful haunting sound?
Well, in Jesus' day, they blew four blasts on the shofar. There was one long blast, and then some staccato blasts, at least nine of those, and then some undulating up and down blasts, and then one more long blast. And it sounded something like this.
Let me hold the mic up to the, shofar. I should tell you just a little sidelight. Dick's Hebrew teacher at the Ulpan told them about the shofar horn. You know, this is the oldest musical instrument known to humanity. And she told their class that they use this horn for the beginning of the Sabbath and also for the Day of Atonement, because the bent shape reminds you of the attitude of repentance before God. Isn't that beautiful? The Day of Atonement. Beautiful. Well, I thought I knew when Sabbath started. Sundown Friday night, but as one Jewish sister taught me, she said, no. She said, Sabbath starts coming in all Friday afternoon, and by sundown, it's all here. Isn't that beautiful? And ever since that, you can just feel it. You know, the sun goes down every day of the week, but Friday afternoon, it's different. The Sabbath starts coming in, and by sundown, it's all here. And just as the Sabbath begins, the Jewish family joins together, and they bring in the Sabbath together as a family. Every Friday night, this precious ceremony is occurring around the world, and there are stories that even during the Holocaust in the concentration camps, Jews would try to snuck in a few candles in their clothes so that at Friday night they could light a candle for God, Sabbath day. So I'm going to light the Sabbath candles and pray the prayer that a Jewish mother prays over her family as the Sabbath begins. Now we brought the seven-branch candlestick, the menorah, the temple menorah, to light tonight, but you don't have to use that. Some families we found used two candles. And this was to symbolize the two statements of the Ten Commandments in Exodus, where we're told that God is our creator, and then in Deuteronomy 5, where Moses is preaching on the Ten Commandments, ties the Sabbath into redemption. And these two great aspects of the Sabbath are joined together in two candles in some traditions. Other families will light a candle for every member of the family. And one family we went, their children were all grown and gone, and so she lit a candle for everybody, all her children, all her grandchildren. They were all over the world, and she prayed over her family. Precious tradition. And I asked them, why do you light candles for the Sabbath? I mean, it's very lovely. I mean, I love candles. In fact, I have so many candles in my home that my students ask me if I used to be Catholic because I have so many candles. You know, they love candles too. And they say, no, it's like this. There's two reasons they gave me. One reason is because you can light a whole room full of candles from one candle, right? Done that at weddings and so forth. You take one candle and everyone else has a candle, and you can light a whole room full of candles with one candle. And when you're all done, the original light is still as bright as ever, even though the flame has been shared with many candles. Just so, they say, God every Sabbath blesses the Sabbath, and the light is as bright as ever, even though the first Sabbath was 6,000 years ago. Another tradition told me, another family told me, oh, it's like this, that God started creation week and said, let there be light. And since every Sabbath is a new creation, they want to start it with light. So I'm going to light these seven candles now, and Jewish people will allow the candles to burn all evening until they go to bed so that they won't have to blow them out. Now that sounds funny to us, but I love the way they say it. You know, Seventh-day Adventists, we say, you can't work on Sabbath. And our Jewish brothers and sisters say, I don't have to work on Sabbath. I don't have to work. I'm free. Isn't that beautiful? So we're going to light these candles tonight and let them burn as long as we can, because it's very warm tonight and they're soft, and I don't want them falling over and starting a fire. So what we will do is light them and pray the prayer, and then we'll see how long we can keep them lit. But I want you to know, if this was authentic, we'd have to let them blow all night. I mean, till bed, till we go to bed. Where did he go? When the mother lights the first candle, in some families, the children will cover their eyes until the mother says the prayer, and then when she says amen, they take their hands from their eyes, and they say the miracle of the Sabbath lights begin. And sometimes the mother, when she lights the candle, she will do some elegant hand motions to draw the sacred flame, the holiness of the Sabbath, into herself as the Sabbath begins. Let's pray. O God of your people Israel, you are holy. And you have made the Sabbath and the children of Israel holy. And you have called upon us to honor the Sabbath with light, with joy, and with peace. As a king and queen give love to one another, as a bride and her bridegroom. And so we have kindled these lights for the love of the Sabbath day. Almighty God, grant me and all my loved ones a chance to truly rest on this Sabbath day. May the light of the candles drive out from among us the spirit of anger and the spirit of harm. Send your blessings to my children that they may walk in the ways of your Torah, your light. And may you ever be their God and mine, O Lord, my Creator and my Redeemer. Amen. When we first started doing this, our son, who's is much too big for me to do this now, I was carrying him on my hip. You know, you become a one-handed mother. It was Friday, I was dusting and cleaning, and I said, John, tonight is going to be Sabbath. And he couldn't talk yet, but he went, he knew that something special would happen on Friday night. After the mother blesses her children and blesses her family with the lighting on the candles, the next thing that happens is just wonderful. The husband blesses his wife. And last Friday night, my husband was in Turkey, and I missed my blessing. So would you bless me tonight, honey?
The choice that I have to read is either from the Song of Solomon or from Proverbs 31. And when I'm in private, I read from the Song of Solomon. But tonight I'm going to read from Proverbs 31. Who can find a wife of strength? For her worth is far above rubies. The heart of this husband trusts in her, and so I have no lack of gain. You do me good all the days of our lives, and you seek wool and flax and willingly work with your hands. You're like the merchant ship that brings our food from afar. You gird yourself with strength and strengthen your arms. You are not afraid of snow, even Michigan snow, for our household, for all of our household is clothed with scarlet. Strength and honor are your clothing. You rejoice in time to come. You open your mouth with kindness, and on your lips are the law of wisdom. You watch over the ways of our household, and you don't eat the bread of idleness. And our children rise up and call you blessed. Many daughters have done well, but you excel them all. I love you, darling.
Oh, don't go away. You can see why I like Friday night, you know. And then after the husband blesses his wife, the wife blesses her husband. She reads to him from Psalm 112, the characteristics of this man of God, and she blesses her husband. Honey, can I bless you tonight? We're really used to doing this in the privacy of our home. So, blessed is the man who fears the Lord, who delights greatly in his commandments. His descendants will be mighty on the earth. Wealth and riches in his hands. His righteousness endures forever. He is gracious, full of compassion, and righteous. He's a good man who deals graciously and lends, and he will guide his affairs with discretion. Surely he will never be shaken. Honey, I just want to thank you for all you do for our home. You have a heavy load you carry at school, but when anything goes wrong at the house, I just have to say, honey, help. And you'll drop all the things that you need to get done and help me. And I just treasure your large umbrella and your large affections, and I thank you for that. I love you. After the husband blesses his wife and the wife blesses her husband, then the father blesses his children. Every Friday night as the Sabbath begins, the children feel their father's strong arms around them and bringing them a Sabbath blessing. And I know I looked earlier and wondered if there might be a couple of kids that would be willing to come up and get a Sabbath blessing. Are there any kids left here that would be willing to come up and get a Sabbath blessing and pretend you're our kids? Are there any here? I know they have their own meetings, and so maybe that won't work. Here comes one. Good.
We've always wanted to have a dozen kids.
How special.
Okay, let's have a prayer. Shall we close our eyes and pray to Jesus? Dear Jesus, I thank you so much for all of these children. I thank you for the privilege of having them, pretending they're our children tonight, and as we are this one big family, that we can bless them. I pray for each one of them. Lord, make them, make the girls like Sarah and Rebecca and Rachel in the Bible, and the boys strong and brave like Samuel and like David and the other boys in the Bible. And each one of you, the Lord bless you, keep you. The Lord lift up his face upon you and give you peace. Shalom. Amen. Thank you, guys. Thank you for coming up.
Thank you very much. When our children were growing up, we tried to keep these special Friday night to be together with them so that they could receive their father's blessing. But one Friday night, I remember when Dick had to be gone and our kids were teenagers, and so I took it upon myself to give the blessing of the Father, and I put my arms around the kids, and they were kind of squirming a little bit, and when I was done, they said, "You're not as good as Dad." and I said, "No, I can't be, because only a father can give a blessing like that." And again, my maturing process continued, because I said, that's what Sabbath is all about. Our Heavenly Father reaching down each Friday night and putting his arms around us and giving us a blessing. A few years ago, my parents invited all their children and grandchildren home for a Christmas, a gala Christmas, and we'd all been home different times, but never all the children and grandchildren and spouses together for a Christmas, and we were there for the whole weekend. And I remember that Friday night, my father told us at supper, "When you're done eating, please come in the living room. I have something I want to say to you." So we gathered in the living room afterwards, and my dad said something like this: "You know, I've been watching Dick and JoAnn bless their children every Friday night for a number of years now, and I wish I'd known that when you were little, but I didn't. So will you let your father bless you tonight?" And my dad went around the family circle and put his hands on each one of us individually and prayed a personal prayer over each one of the members of his family. It took almost an hour, and by the time Daddy was done, the room was so filled with the Spirit of God, I could hardly breathe. It was so holy. It was so holy. And again, I was reminded, for so long, I thought I was telling God how good I was keeping the Sabbath, and he was saying, "Thank you very much, but someday I hope you'll understand that the Sabbath is something I'm giving you." And as we watch these precious traditions by our Jewish brothers and sisters, I suddenly realized that they were onto something. And I was praising God, and I said, "Lord, I said I tried so hard not to come here. I tried so hard, and now I see why you nudged me so hard. Because you knew I needed to see something about the Sabbath that I never knew was there. This new understanding and this new appreciation that it's a gift of God, not something I do for Him. Just like salvation, we don't do anything for salvation. The Sabbath is nothing we do, it's God's doing. And He wants to come for 24 hours every 7 days and give you a blessing like you can get nowhere else. Even if you were the only person on the earth, he would do this. And even with all of us, he can minister to us each individually as if we were the only person on earth, because he's God. And he stands on tiptoes yearning to give us this blessing. And I started thinking, what if in every Adventist home, every Friday night as the sun goes down, family ties were restored, and husbands expressed affection for their wives, and wives were grateful to their husbands, and husbands, fathers expressed affection to their children. What a difference that might make in some Adventist homes. Because you know what the Jewish people write? They say it's not that the Jews keep the Sabbath. It's the Sabbath that keeps the Jews. And Ellen White caught on to this, and she said, "You know, if we hadn't lost the Sabbath, there wouldn't be an atheist today. Because the Sabbath has that much staying power, that much staying power." And so I started talking to our Jewish brothers and sisters, and I said, "Well, how did you think this up? I mean, this is just so beautiful, this joining of family and Sabbath and these precious traditions. How did you think it up?" And they said, "It's in Torah." I said, "Torah? I read Torah, and I don't see it there." And they said, "Oh, yes." And they showed me some text. Turn to Exodus 31. Exodus 31. And this is a favorite text of Seventh-day Adventists, and we've read this many, many times, but I never saw this before. And this is God talking, Exodus 31, pick it up in verse 12, and it's, the Lord spoke to Moses saying, and so we know this is God talking. Then we'll pick it up down here in verses 16 and 17. God talking, therefore, the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations as a perpetual covenant. And it is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he was rested and refreshed. Did you get it? I didn't get it. And so they pointed out to me something extraordinary. They said, you know, there it says in verse 16 where said God says, I want you to observe the Sabbath. And on the verse 17 it said God made the heavens and the earth. And see, our wonderful translators smooth that out, but it's the same verb. It's the same verb. There's no such thing as observing the Sabbath. That's much too passive. This is how our Jewish brothers and sisters read it. They say, therefore the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath to make the Sabbath, just as God made the heavens and the earth. And they said, see, you're supposed to make the Sabbath with all the creativity and love and joy with which God made the Sabbath and created the world. I said, wow, that's exciting. But how do you know it was all that exciting when God created the world? That's in Torah. It's in Genesis, don't you see? And so they showed me Genesis, and they said, don't you see? God created the world, and he made a poem. It was so beautiful. He didn't just arbitrarily throw things out there and call them into being. He made a poem, and I said, really? And I was thinking, poem, English, you know, Mary had a little lamb, its fleece as white as snow, and everywhere that Mary went, the lamb was sure to go. And that's English poetry. That's not Hebrew poetry. When Hebrews want to make poetry, they do it differently. They don't rhyme end words, they rhyme ideas. And so they'll take one idea and they'll say it one way, and then they'll sort of repeat it very little bit and say it another way. And then you know you're in a Hebrew poetry. Let me give you an example, one you know very well. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, saying the same thing, but just slightly different. And when you see anything, an effect like that, you know there's poetry. Well, I said, well, okay, that's very nice, but how do you find the creation week like that? He said, oh, beautiful. They said, the title of the poem is in Genesis 1, chapter 2. And the Lord, and the earth was without form and void. The Lord, the world was formless and empty. And then God proceeded to take 3 days, and he formed the world. And on the last 3 days, he filled it up. And they say this wonderful corresponds. Day one, God says, let there be light. Oh. On the fourth day, we have a big blackboard here, right? On the fourth day, what did he fill up the light with? The sun, moon, and stars. On the second day, what does God create? He creates, he separates the air from the water. And on the fifth day, he fills it up with the air with the birds and the water with the fish. And on the third day, he creates the dry land. And on the sixth day, he fills up the dry land with people and land animals. And then he takes those 6 days and he adds the Sabbath. And he takes those 7 days and he bends it into a week that has stood in all history. All history. And people have dabbled with it, and they've tried to make 10-day weeks and 6-day weeks, but anthropologists are amazed that this 7-day week is found all over the world, in all people groups, in all cultures, and all the history of the world. Where does it come from? And the Jewish people said, it's right there. God's telling us the first 6 days he created matter, and on the seventh day he created time. And don't you wish you could create time? But God says, I'm that great. I'm the God of space and time. And he takes these 7 days and bends it into a week, and it holds firm, and he punctuates it with the Sabbath. And it's a marvelous thing. You can take this six surrounding the seven, and it's a part of nature itself. That's many eye lenses are built with this six surrounding the seven. You can do it with coins. Take seven identical coins, seven quarters, seven nickels, seven dimes, whatever. It has to be the seven same coins. You can form a perfect circle with the center in the middle. It just matches perfectly, because that's the structure of reality. And God's trying to tell us how glorious it is. And in fact, Philo, who was in a contemporary of Jesus, he says, Sabbath is the birthday of the world. Whoa. Well, at my age, a birthday every 5 years would be adequate. Thank you very much. When my kids are growing up, they kind of hinted they'd like a birthday every month. You know, the present sense, birthdays are fun. But God said, a year isn't enough, a month isn't enough. I want you to have the birthday of the world every week. It's such an extraordinary thing. We're thinking of the great God of the universe who can do anything. He can measure time. He can call things into existence that never were. And the psalmist couldn't get over how great God was. You notice all the time in the Psalms, they're saying, I'm going to praise you for your wonderful works. And they said, it's just glorious. And I said, whoa, that's really beautiful. And they said, furthermore, did you know that the whole universe was celebrating when God was creating? I said, really? Where's that? And they said, in the book of Job. So I went to the book of Job, and there it is, chapter 38. And you remember Job is suffering. It's the worst case of suffering in the whole scriptures. No one suffered more than Job except Jesus himself. And Satan has a challenge at the book as the book opens. He says, you know, God, no one really loves you. And God says, have you considered my servant Job? And he says, oh, sure, he loves you. Look what he did for him. He's got good health. He's got nice kids, a lot of money, the wise man. All the people come and talk to him. He shares his wisdom. Yeah, you take that all away, and you'll see that nobody really loves you. And so God allows Satan to do everything to this man except kill him. And Job hasn't an idea of what's going on. Hasn't an idea. And he and his friends argue about what's the cause of suffering with all these answers, and no one got it right. Except Job said, I will not lose faith in God through all of this. Well, God finally comes, you know, chapter 38, God's longest speech in the Bible, four chapters, and he comes to Job. And you would think that God would describe the situation and explain it to Job so he would understand. But no, God, you know what God does? He teaches zoology 101. He talks about animals. He talks about the wild horse pawing the ground ready to gallop. He talks about the Leviathan. He talks about all these wild creatures that we can't possibly tame. And God tells Job, if you can't understand why I created these, there's no way you can understand all the things I'm doing on this earth. But in the process, God gives a hint of what went on in creation week. And he tells Job at the beginning of chapter 38, then the Lord appeared to Job out of the whirlwind and said, where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Who stretched its line upon it, and to what were its foundations fastened when I laid the cornerstones? And then God gives this wonderful clue. When all the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy. Oh, when God was creating, the whole universe was cheering on. Wow! Whoa, did you see that? And the sons of God were shouting for joy at the wonderful week of creation that God made. And then God came at the end of the week, and he rested from all his work that he had done. And he wasn't tired, but it's that word in Hebrews, like, this is wonderful. This is wonderful. And he rejoices with Adam and Eve in this nest that he'd prepared for them. And they said, did you know? There's another clue in Genesis 1:2 about what was in God's heart as he was creating. Genesis 1:2, it says there, the earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. There it is. Now, some translations put it in the Spirit of God was brooding over the waters. But you know, we're learning that the five books of Moses are so technically superior writing, that they're just beginning to see what sophisticated writing that Moses used as he wrote this book. And in this case, he uses this word hovering only one other time. He describes the Spirit of God hovering over the face of the water, and he uses it one more time in Deuteronomy 32. And let's read this, because it'll help us see what Moses is meaning when he writes this passage about the Spirit of God. Talks about God here. This is Moses' farewell sermon. God found Israel in a desert land, in the wasteland, a howling wilderness. He encircled him, he instructed him, he kept him as the apple of his eye, and as an eagle stirs up her nest and hovers over her young, spreading out her wings and taking them up on her wings. And so the Lord alone led them. And God says, every time you see a mother eagle stirring up her nest and hovering over her young and taking care of her family, he said, that's what I want you to think about the Holy Spirit when he was ready to create. Not brooding over the water. He was thinking with his heart full, oh, this nest I'm going to make my family, and this perfect nest, this perfect, perfect home for my family. And our Jewish brothers and sisters have seen this, and they said, oh, what was in God's heart as he was creating? No wonder we must celebrate this great God every 7 days. Well, then they move to another text, another favorite text of Seventh-day Adventists, and they showed me something there I'd never seen before, Isaiah 58. Now, this is how I've always read it, always felt it, Isaiah 58:13. If you turn away your foot from the Sabbath, from doing your pleasure on my holy day. Right? Have you felt that? We never get to the next line. And that's the whole peak of this whole thing. But you know, our Jewish brothers and sisters have never stumbled over this verse, because they know what the word pleasure means. See, we read it in English and we think, oh, pleasure. Well, anything that's pleasurable can't be Sabbathy. And so we say, pleasure, pleasure. We got to be somber and we got to be still and be sober, and nothing can be happy because we can't do our own pleasure. But that's not what it says in the Hebrew language. And the same word for pleasure is used up in the early part of the chapters, verses 3, 4, 5, and 6, somewhere out there. And it's talking about business and employees and wages and your everyday normal work that you do the rest of the week. And so our Jewish brothers and sisters translate this verse this way: if you turn away your foot from the Sabbath, from pursuing your own affairs on my holy day, God says, and call the Sabbath a delight. God says, don't do the ordinary run-of-the-mill stuff. Working is fun, and I hope you like your work. But man, the Sabbath is a delight, and I want you to just rejoice with me. And not only that, but that word delight in Hebrew is extraordinary. There's, what is it, a dozen words for delight, honey? The 12 words for delight, and the intensity builds up, 12 of them. And you have normal delight, and then gets more to average delight, and then middle delight, and then high delight, and then there's this peak word for delight. It's royal delight, like kings and queens share. Now, I saw a documentary once on how Queen Elizabeth lives in Buckingham Palace. And I don't live that way, but I could get used to it. But on Sabbath, according to this text, God says, put aside your ordinary work, because this is a day of royal delight. Royal delight. And so you know what my husband says? When he says, when you have these dishes to do, and he says, honey, you're a queen today. Tonight after sundown, we'll return to being household drudges, and we'll do the dishes then. But today, you're a royal queen. Celebrate and relax, and let's enjoy the glories of God together. And that's what it's all about. And you know, I found a neat quote in Ellen White. She says, if all possible, leave your dishes till after Sabbath and enjoy the Sabbath. Isn't that great? But see, we spend so much time misinterpreting this verse that we don't even understand what our Jewish brothers and sisters do. And so they get on to the next line, the peak of the whole thing, and call the Sabbath a delight. We never get there. But they said, that's what the heart of this thing, the Sabbath, is to be a royal delight. And that's why the mother prays in her prayer, as a king and queen give love to one another. Yeah, to remind them that this day you are a child of a king, and you're a royal delight, and God wants to be with you. Let aside everything else. Don't pursue your own affairs. Do something more special than that. And then I said, okay, you're convincing me. But how did you think up joining family and Sabbath together? Is that just a nice, sweet idea? And they said, no, that's in the Ten Commandments. I said, what? In the Ten Commandments? I never saw that. So they said, let's go there. So we turned back to Exodus 20. In the first place, they pointed out several things about the Sabbath commandment. They said, the heart of the Father is in that first word. Remember. And they said, that's God putting his heart on his sleeve, and he's saying, will you remember? And God's on his tiptoes saying, hoping someone will remember and fellowship with him and receive the great Sabbath blessing that he wants to give. Will you remember? You can just hear him up there. Will you? Will you remember? Will you? And then my Jewish brothers and sisters showed me something that I've never seen before. And they said, in the heart of the Ten Commandments is the Sabbath commandment and the commandment honoring family ties. And you notice they're even formulated different. All the others are the first three are the thou shalt nots, and the last five are the thou shalt nots. But in the center is the Sabbath commandment and the commandment honoring family ties. And so they say God himself joined Sabbath and family. And so they've developed these wonderful family traditions, bringing the Sabbath and family together and restoring affection and love and family bonds that have been too busy to happen during the week, but on Friday night, you restore them all again. Oh, that was so moving to me. I'd never seen that before. And I got to thinking, what if Adventists would join Sabbath and family together? Ellen White writes that all we have left of the Garden of Eden is the Sabbath and the family. And every Friday night as the Sabbath began, God calls us back to the Garden of Eden. And our Jewish brothers and sisters have seen this for thousands of years. And I thank God that he nudged me so hard to go there, because it's made all the difference in my thinking about this day. And I'm finally learning to receive it as a gift and not try to offer it to God to please him. And I finally seen that this great creator really wants to be my heavenly father and restore me every 7 days. I mess up during the week. Things don't go well and my heart gets full of bitterness and impatience and all these things that pull at me. But then every Friday night at sundown, I can let it go and come and unencumbered to my heavenly father. And he says, it's okay, JoAnn. I love you and I'm enjoying you, watching you learn to walk. It's all right. And he restores me and forgives me, and in the face of my creator, I'm renewed again. Tonight, as we started this meeting together, I was so moved by the songs that the Parks family sang about the cross and about God's healing blood. And you know, the Lord of the Sabbath is our Savior. He's our Savior. And our son lives in Oregon now, and he was on the campgrounds tonight singing for the young adult meeting, and I sent Dick over there quick to ask him if he would be willing to come and sing a closing song for us here tonight. It's a song he wrote about the cross. Even as a young boy, the cross has always moved John. In fact, I'd be doing something and say, Mom, you gotta come hear this song. And it was always about the cross, about the Lamb of God. And God gave John the gift of writing music and gave him this special song. And tonight, as we close this meeting, be reminded that your Savior is the Lord of the Sabbath.
Of love is this? What kind of love is this? That God would form us from the clay, knowing we like sheep would go astray, that we would spurn his holy. Offer himself as our kinds of love is this? What kind of love is this? That God would go prepare a place, the pain and sin He would erase. Oh, death, where is your edge, old sting, oh grave? Where is your victory? And oh, what kind of love is this? And oh, what kind of love is this that He would wear His scars for eternity just to be with you, to be with me? What kind of love is this? What kind of love is this that God would do all that He can and yearn for us to understand? What kind of love is this? What kind of love is this?
I invite you to stand for the benediction. What kind of love is this? O God, our Creator, our Redeemer, our Sanctifier, and one who is soon to glorify us when You come again. Thank You that this love is encapsulated in that one great gift of the Sabbath. Lord, I pray that You will bless each family, each individual here tonight as we see the Sabbath through new eyes, not as something we give to You, but as something we receive from You, a gift of love, a gift of Your Son. Thank You, in Jesus' name, amen. Shabbat shalom. Happy Sabbath.